Many of you remember when you were baptized. I mean, not like remember it, because if you're Lutheran, right, you probably don't remember it, because you were probably wee little, right? Like next week. Come back next week. We're going to have a baptism next week of twins. So, would have been great if it could have been this weekend, but that's the way things work, so. But you probably don't remember, actually remember your baptism, but you were told about it. But how many of you really know the date you were baptized? The date you were baptized. I actually do. I was baptized June 30th, 1991, at a Baptist church in Milltown, Ohio. I was pushed under the water. I have a picture of it, of the man who's getting ready to push me underneath the water. The last thing he said to me before he pushed me under the water, he had me hold my nose like this, and his hand was on my hand. He said, "Don't fight me." I was like, whoa, wait a minute. Reminded me of a picture I just saw on Facebook a couple days ago. It was a picture of John and Jesus in the river, right? And Jesus said, "What are you trying to do, drown me?" And then John replies, "Well, if you wanted to get sprinkled, you should have found John the Methodist." Right? It's about baptism. But why is baptism so important? Why do we have a day in the church where we celebrate the baptism of Jesus? How many of our Gospels give us a story of Jesus' birth? We say two. Really, I could argue that and say it's only one. Luke is really the only one that gives us a nativity. Matthew gives us the journey of the wise men coming to visit him, which is probably 2 years later, so it's not actually a birth story. I mean, it's close enough that we could say that it's a birth story. But how many? There's four Gospels. And even if we say that two of them give the birth story, that's 50%. How many books in the Bible talk about Jesus' baptism? I need to set my phone down because I need to be in. There are six books in the Bible that specifically talk about the importance of Jesus' baptism. The Gospel of Mark thinks that it's the most important thing. It doesn't even give us anything about Jesus' birth at all. It goes straight from the beginning of the Gospel of the good news of Jesus Christ to John the Baptist appeared in the Jordan baptizing for the repentance of sins. There's nothing about his birth because his baptism is more important. And why is this? Why is baptism more important? How many of you know what that little symbol is for the title of the sermon today? Raise your hand, Karen. I know you do. It's, yes, but, what is it, somebody? Tell Clyde what it is. It's a Facebook-like. You wouldn't know. It's okay. It's okay. We all love you for that, Clyde, and that's perfect, so it's okay. How many of you are on Facebook? Raise your hands. I know the little one. You raise your hands. How many of you have more friends than you could ever possibly imagine on Facebook? Right? And then you look for them to click the pictures and stuff. You look at how many likes you get on your thing, right? We have Twitter. We have Instagram. We have Tumblr. People heart pictures on Instagram. If you don't know Instagram, it's okay. But we go for affirmation, right? We all are seeking affirmation. We're all seeking to be somebody who fits in and is loved by the world around us. And that's something that we learn at a young age, right? That we have to fit in, that we need to be accepted. Right? And then as we get to adults, we learn what it is to continue to do the things that continue to keep us to be accepted or to be part of the group or to fit in or to not be ostracized and put out. Right? You do things because if you were the way that you were, that people wouldn't necessarily like it? Are there things that you do to make other people happy, to like you more? Interesting this morning on the baptism of Jesus and the fact that the baptism is most important. And next week we'll give these twins candles. And how many of you have a candle at home in a box that's never been burned? since you got baptized. That's the absolute wrong way we need to be doing this. And we can institute a change in this system. Tomorrow is actually the anniversary of my middle daughter's baptism. She was baptized when she was not even a year old on the baptism of Jesus on January 12th, 2003. We've never lit her candle to celebrate the anniversary of her baptism. I say that to you because this is something that I've never done myself with my family. And to me, that's sad. Because the baptism of Jesus is so important. And why is that? Because the heavens opened up. Can you picture it here? We're out in the Jordan River. Here's John baptizing all these people. And there's all these families around. They're probably in the river and playing. And they're washing their children. They're washing themselves. They're washing around. They're having fun. They're playing out in the river. And then Jesus comes down the bank and he walks out into the river in this very public moment. And then the moment he goes under the water and he comes back up, everybody disappears and it's just Jesus and God. And the Spirit descends upon him like a dove. And he hears the voice. Why does the Spirit have to descend upon Jesus? Wasn't Jesus born of the Holy Spirit? Doesn't he already have the Holy Spirit in him? It's a little bit ironic, isn't it, that the Spirit has to descend on him in the baptism? It's also ironic that Mark specifically says that Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee. That's basically like saying that he came from nowhere. Nazareth was an unknown town that nobody of any importance had ever come from. He came from nowhere. And the Spirit descended upon him, and that's not the important part there. The other thing that we have to know is the Spirit is the symbol of a dove. What is a dove? What's a dove? It's a bird. Does anybody know what kind of bird it is? It's a pigeon. It's an ugly trash bird. What do pigeons do? They eat trash. They scavenge. They eat all of the stuff that nobody else wants to, and they're dirty. And this is the image of the Holy Spirit that we have descending upon Jesus. And why is that important? Because here's the thing. It's not about getting admiration. It's not about getting the light. It's not about fitting in. It's about being accepted. See, there's a difference between acceptance, being accepted, and fitting in. Fitting in is where we learn as a young child and do as we grow older as adults, where we do the things that we know we need to do in order for people to like us. That's fitting in. Acceptance is where people accept you as you are and love you where you're at and help you move forward in your life as you are right now. No holds barred, nothing held back. Accepted as you are. And that's exactly what God does. Exactly what happens. When that trash bird descends, it comes back up as a treasure chest. God takes what is awful and makes it into something beautiful. God accepted Jesus as he was, not for anything that he did, not for anything that he was going to do, but just the way that he was as a human person to go forward and to do his will. And that's exactly what Jesus did in his ministry, which right after this, Jesus is pushed out into the wilderness, which we'll read about in about 3 weeks, 4 weeks, to face temptation, to face trials. And then after that, he goes out into the world and he does ministry. What does he do? He tells people that God loves them and accepts them where they are and will take their lives and transform it if they will only allow him to. God accepts you as you are. When you came to this font, you heard those exact same words. The heavens were torn apart. God reached down and touched you and said, "You are my beloved child. And you I am well pleased." Not because of what you've done, not because of what you will do, but just because you are. I love you just as you are. You're accepted just as you are by God. And that's the most important thing to hear this morning. That's the most important thing to remember. It's not about Jesus' birth. It's about Jesus' acceptance of each and every one of us as we are, to not leave us where we're at, but to move us forward and to give us the life that God has always proclaimed to us. So now I want all of us to say together,
going to say it once, and then we'll all repeat it back. We're going to say, I am a beloved child of God, and He is well pleased with me.
I am a beloved child of God, and He is well pleased with me.
Say it again.
I am a beloved child of God, and He is well pleased with me.
If you have to say it over and over again to make yourselves believe it later, go ahead and do it. Okay?
Because it is absolutely 100% true. You are a beloved child of God, and God is very well pleased with you. So go into the world, just as Jesus did, and tell everybody you know that if they will allow God to accept them, that God will take them as they are and give them the life that they could have never possibly imagined.